the Sinai Desert. Moses has led his people out of bondage in Egypt. They are weary from their long trek to find the promised land. It has become clear to Moses that they need a set of laws to live by. According to the Bible, Moses leaves his people and ascends Mount Sinai to communicate with God. He has gone so long that the people become restless and, believing Moses is dead, build a gold idol to worship. Is this story true? Did God give Moses the Ten Commandments? Did the Exodus really occur? Or is all this just a folktale? Can science shed any light on this controversial part of the Bible?
The story of Moses receiving the Ten Commandments on Mount Sinai is full of inconsistencies. It is impossible to sort fact from fiction.
The Ten Commandments account by Moses is 100% factual, and there are no contradictions. It's a straightforward story, also confirmed in the Talmud and other ancient rabbinical commentaries.
To determine whether the Ten Commandments were given by God to Moses on stone tablets, we need to ask one simple question. Where are these tablets? No one has ever found these stone tablets. A possible explanation is that they never existed.
We can prove that the Ten Commandments were given to Moses on stone tablets. And we also know exactly where the stone tablets are today.
There seems to be no end to the controversy surrounding the five books of Moses about major events in Israelite history, including the Exodus from Egypt and Moses receiving the Ten Commandments. Was there actually a real Mount Sinai? And were there ever stone tablets on which the Ten Commandments were written? And if so, where are they now? The Bible says when Moses first led the people out of bondage in Egypt, they were of one mind and one goal. But before long, it soon became apparent that they were not one people. However, this was not one unified group, but hundreds of thousands of people drawn from 12 different tribes that had been spread out all over Egypt for centuries.
Using the lowest estimate for men, women, and children that supposedly were a part of the Exodus, the count would run over 2 million people, plus their livestock. If they were placed on a modern four-lane highway, the line of march would cover the road from edge to edge for 150 miles. If all these Hebrews wandered the Sinai Desert for 40 years under Exodus, where is the archaeological evidence of their passage? The Exodus never happened the way it's described in the Bible.
The biblical story of the Exodus is an eyewitness account written by a layman to his contemporaries. Although the writer was not a scholarly historian, there are enough historical kernels indicating that the account is factual, both from an archaeological and Egyptian anthropological perspective. Archaeology provides background information for unlocking narratives and events such as the Exodus account. In this case, the account contains sufficient place names cross-referenced in non-biblical Sumerian and Assyrian cuneiform tablets to confirm the accuracy of the Exodus account and to assure scholars that it was not an account invented for later consumption.
According to the Old Testament biblical account in the book of Exodus, the weary Israelites traveled long and hard on narrow roads before reaching Mount Sinai. Within a month after leaving Egypt, each passing day saw the plight of the people grow worse. Many were running out of food, children were beginning to suffer, and the people were accusing Moses of bringing them into the desert to die.
My God! Without your help, your people are destroyed. There's little food in the tents. How shall we survive in this wilderness with nothing in our bellies but bitterness? How, oh Lord?
According to the Bible, God told Moses that the people would have bread in the morning and meat at night.
The Lord has spoken to me, Joshua. He has told me how the people shall be fed. Praise be his holy name.
Then the people did as Moses instructed. They were filled with wonder as they gathered the strange honey-flavored drops found near desert plants each morning. They called this manna from heaven. And in the evening, clouds of quail fell at their feet, giving them all the meat they could eat, as Moses had promised.
This manna appearing every morning and birds dropping out of the sky every night makes the Bible totally unbelievable. How could this possibly have happened?
The manna from heaven, which appeared each morning with the dew, was probably the round secretions left on the tamarisk bushes by burrowing insects. The honey-like hard drops are gathered by shaking the branches over cloth and then ground into flour. The manna phenomenon still occurs in the Arabian deserts. Even today, the desert Bedouins gather and use it, still calling it manna from heaven.
Both biblical and non-biblical evidence provides a very clear picture of the quail phenomenon. In April and September, these birds migrate by the millions between Europe and Africa. A strong wind, as the Bible indicated, blew vast flocks of these quail off course about 100 miles inland, where they dropped from exhaustion of fighting the wind. The Israelites could have easily gathered millions of these birds and used them for food.
The priests, scribes who wrote the five books of the Bible attributed to Moses could not even decide on whether the sacred mountain of Moses was named Sinai or Horeb. 37 times it's called Sinai, and 17 times it's called Horeb.
While the mountain on which Moses received the Ten Commandments is called alternately Sinai or Horeb in the scriptures, there is little difficulty in explaining this apparent contradiction. During King David's reign, two versions of the same scripture were brought together in a manner that allowed both northern and southern Israelite tribes to keep their familiar identifiers for geographic places. Sinai and Horeb are the same mountain. Nothing in the Bible suggests that they are not.
Probably due to the many years in Egyptian bondage, the differences among the various tribal groups were much greater than their similarities. Strange Egyptian gods were still worshipped, and ancient pagan rituals still practiced. There was no common law to fit crimes and punishment, and violence began spreading like a plague. It soon became apparent to Moses that these differences would destroy the people if they could not be resolved.
Brothers, brothers, please,
please.
The Bible says that God called upon Moses to climb the heights of Sinai and there to wait upon his appearance. Then, while Moses prepared his brother Aaron to sit in his place, the news spread quickly through the camp. It is speculated, due to the constant grumbling against Moses, that some men favored no laws and even hated Moses.
Numidian, why? You still live well, Azariah.
We have all lived well. But for how much longer?
We know now what all the fuss was about, why Moses moved the nation to Sinai. He claims the Lord God has called him to the top of the mountain to receive the laws.
What laws?
A covenant, he claims. Moses is to receive a covenant of laws from the God Jehovah, which will bind the nation together forever.
This must not happen. If there's ever a chance for us to become the rightful leaders of this nation, we must never permit this to happen.
But Moses has regained a great deal of the people's faith.
The people are like the wine in this vessel. They'll flow in whatever direction they're tilted.
What do you propose?
When does Moses go up the mountain?
By the first light of the morning.
Good. Let's start promoting our plans to the tribal leaders.
The Moses Ten Commandments story is a complete copy of other myths with the names and places changed. The Persian Book of Law was given to Zoroaster amid thunder and lightning. Dionysius, the Greek lawgiver, was shown holding two tablets of stone with laws chiseled into them. For this reason, you cannot take the story of Moses literally.
Zoroaster and Dionysius came hundreds of years after the events of Moses on Mount Sinai. And if there was plagiarism, it was not by Moses.
The Bible says God had commanded Moses to ascend the sacred mountain and seek the presence of the Lord.
Joshua, here's where I shall leave you. This is where you shall wait for me.
There can be no doubt that a unifying code of laws was needed to avoid a disastrous end to the Exodus. And for hundreds of years, what happened at this time has been a trying point of contention among Bible scholars.
There are three conflicting stories about the Ten Commandments in the Bible. In one place, Moses cut the stones and wrote on them. In another, Moses cut the stones and God wrote on them. And in the third place, God cut the stones and God wrote on them. If Moses and God can't get the story straight, why should we believe it?
The Bible is very clear. God originally wrote the Ten Commandments on stone tablets of his own making and gave them to Moses. After Moses smashed the original tablets when he saw the Israelites worshiping the golden calf, Moses cut another set of tablets, and God wrote on those too. There's really no significant evidence in the Bible of a third set of stone tablets. Any reference to a third set comes from a misinterpretation of one passage where the Bible is really telling about the second set of tablets.
Even when Moses had been gone only a few days, the people began to worry that he would never return. In a week, Aaron had nothing left to say that would ease the leaders' minds. But there were others in the vast camp of the Israelites that grew more pleased at each passing day that Moses did not return. For Moses, time was at a standstill. His entire consciousness was focused on the moments when God spoke to him of the laws that would make his covenant.
Lord, why have you brought me here?
With Moses gone so long, the plots that had been simmering in darkness now found their way into the light of day.
We've talked and we've planned. If we do not act now, we may never get another chance.
The key to the success of our plan is Aaron. But he must be convinced that Moses is dead.
When he's assured we want him for a new leader, he'll go along.
As the weeks became a month, with Moses still absent, the everyday problems of governing grew larger and more difficult. Aaron was not Moses. The great responsibilities of first leadership were too much for him. Every passing day, Aaron lost a little more control.
Enough! Enough! I have to rest. I need time to think. Leave me in peace for a while.
Lord Aaron.
The plotters had cunningly waited until Aaron was weakened, both by the heavy burden of Moses' office and worry for his brother.
Azariah has news of Moses, which is only for your ears. He'll tell no one else, not even us.
Something has happened to my brother.
Please come with us.
All day and into the night, Aaron listened. They convinced him that Moses was dead and that the tribes would soon fall into a terrible war among themselves without central leadership. They proposed themselves as the governing council and him as their leader.
You yourself must make the golden calf image. Your gold work is known for its skill.
But why should I have to make the idol? Surely there are more skilled artists.
Because the people must know that their new God is of your making. You are Moses' heir and successor.
People will be much happier worshiping a God they can see. And with us as the council, life will be much easier for you.
We've explained everything. Now is the time for a decision. What do you answer us, Lord Aaron?
Get in. is magnificent, Aaron.
You've surpassed yourself.
It's just what the people needed.
The golden calf that Aaron was talked into making was an image of the Egyptian god Apis. This god was worshipped only one day of the year, on the Egyptian New Year's Day. It was preceded by 5 days of party-making, all aimed at bringing a prosperous and safe new year. It was something the Israelites desperately needed, fearing that Moses had died on Mount Sinai.
Now that the new God had been proclaimed by the leaders, there was feasting and celebrations all through the vast camp. Then, even as the people in the camps were turning away from Jehovah for the love of a pagan idol, Moses was receiving the word of God.
I am the Lord thy God. Thou shalt have no other gods before me.
Unlike other law codes, such as the Code of Hammurabi, which was written on an 8-foot stela and stood out in the open air, the Ten Commandment tablets were portable and designed to be kept as a sacred treasure. Although ancient Egyptian and Babylonian stelas, tablets, and wall reliefs were usually done in limestone, basalt rock, or diorite, there is strong evidence that the Ten Commandment tablets were done in granite or marble, rock types that are found at the Jebel El Lahz Mount Sinai site in Saudi Arabia.
Aaron's heart was troubled, but the plotters leaped with delight when Aaron put the idol upon the altar of stone. Their blasphemy was complete. God already knew of their idolatry and was set on destroying the Israelites when Moses interceded and with the Ten Commandments hastened down the mountain to confront the Israelites.
Come, faithful Joshua. Let us bring the law of God down to the people.
What were the Ten Commandments? We asked Dr. Robert Bergen.
The first four commandments were concerned with devotion to God. The fifth commandment demanded respect for one's parents and set the standards for human relations and civil law. Murder, adultery, and theft were outlawed by the next three commandments, indicating the sacredness of life, marriage, and property. Israelites were not to offer false evidence in courts. And by this commandment, the sacredness of justice was set forth. The final commandment demanded that one's heart and mind not covet a neighbor's possessions.
When Moses reached the base of the mount, he was filled with sudden horror.
Oh, Israel! What have you done? Turned your backs on Almighty God. Even as Jehovah our Lord has made you his chosen people, you would go whoring after false gods. Must you make an abomination in your own house? Oh, Israel, you are not worthy to receive the law of God. Smite the idolaters! All ye who would follow the word of the living God, rise up now! Purge them from our midst! Strike now for the Lord our God!
The Levite tribe, consecrated to God's service, sided with Moses and killed over 3,000 idolaters to establish law and order among the Israelites. Even as the faithful under Joshua slew the idolaters, Moses destroyed the golden calf.
Thank you.
But even while the terrible fires of vengeance burned through the camp, forgiveness and reconciliation were already beginning. According to the Bible, Moses chiseled out a second set of stone tablets and again went to the top of Mount Sinai.
Here an artisan is cutting and shaping stone tablets with much the same tools and methods as Moses would have used. Moses would have been able to hew and finish the stone tablets that he carried for his rendezvous on Mount Sinai. These two pieces of granite stone carved in Israel are probably a very close replica of the real stone tablets, complete with the Ten Commandments chiseled on them.
But even as we can demonstrate the probability of the stone tablets, there is controversy surrounding a site that fits the description of Mount Sinai in the Bible.
There is no archaeological evidence for the 12 different alleged sites of Mount Sinai. Actually, none of the suggested sites in the Sinai Peninsula fit the biblical requirements. The traditional site called Jebel Musa and located near St. Catherine's Monastery fails all of the historical, geographic, and archaeological tests. This popular site was identified in the 3rd century by Queen Helena, the mother of Emperor Constantine. She was a mystic who endeavored to identify holy places with little regard for biblical or geographic facts.
Some recent and very exciting archaeological discoveries have led scientists away from the traditional sites on the Sinai Peninsula across the Gulf of Aqaba to an intriguing site in Saudi Arabia.
Jebel el-Laws meets the biblical criteria for the true mountain of Moses. First, it had to be located in ancient Midian, which is in present-day Saudi Arabia. Secondly, on the backside of the mountain, there must be a vast desert as you see here. Thirdly, it must be located completely outside of Egypt and its controlled territories, which would exclude the Sinai Peninsula. None of the other proposed mountain sites fits all these requirements except Jebel el-Laws.
In 1988, we traveled the Exodus route from the tip of the Sinai Peninsula into Saudi Arabia, using the Bible and satellite imagery to find the actual route. Inland, 33 kilometers, we found the Bitter Springs of Marah, as mentioned in Exodus 15. This dirt sample from the springs has been chemically analyzed and was found to contain excessive iron and dissolved salts, making it very bitter. Continuing along the route, we came to the clear water springs mentioned in Exodus 15:27. Here, caves were being excavated by Saudi archaeologists. They said they had found writings in these caves indicating that Moses had come through this area and that the tombs of Jethro, the father-in-law of Moses, and Zipporah, the wife of Moses, were found in these caves.
Important archaeological evidence was discovered at Jebel el-Laws, which further supports the biblical account. We found the stone boundary markers for keeping the Israelites off the mountain. But most startling, we found an 8-foot petroglyph of the Egyptian Apis bull god in a campground large enough and with enough water for the entire Exodus tribe.
To our amazement, we found the top of the mountain to be black, as if the rocks had been burnt, possibly confirming the biblical scripture that the Lord descended upon it in fire and smoke.
Recently, in a surprising move, the Saudi government closed down the Jebel el-Laws site abruptly and posted a military guard to prevent further exploration of the site.
If it allows archaeological excavations of ancient Israelite sites in Saudi Arabia, the House of Saud opens itself up to the anger of the Arab world.
Was there a real Mount Sinai? The evidence for Mount Sinai being in Saudi Arabia is overwhelming. Were there 10 commandments engraved in 2 stone tablets, as the Bible declares? Well, the historical evidence certainly argues in favor of the Moses' 10 commandments account. If we only knew where these tablets were today, we could be sure. But perhaps we already do know. In an archaeological expedition led by Rabbi Shlomo Gorin under the temple ruins in the city of Jerusalem, a heart-stopping discovery was made.
We were excavating under the Temple Mount in Jerusalem when we came to an underground room in the direction of the Holy of the Holies. And it was the Ark of the Covenant that Moses placed the Ten Commandments in. But when we came close to the Holy of the Holies, the Arab management of the Temple Mount decided to stop our digging, and they erected a wall in order to stop us from getting to the Holy Ark.
Someday, when the earth is a more peaceful place, we'll all get to see the stone tablets containing the original Ten Commandments upon which our own judicial system is based. Hopefully, we won't have to wait too long.
These latest archaeological and scientific findings provide strong evidence for establishing that the Israelite Exodus actually occurred and that Moses led these Hebrews to Mount Sinai, where he received the Ten Commandments from God. And if Israeli archaeologists are correct, these ancient tablets are still in existence, buried in a secret chamber under Temple Mount in Jerusalem. But the real story of the Ten Commandments is not whether the tablets still exist today, but rather that these tablets given by God became the cornerstone to the Western legal system and the morality code for our society. In recent years, the Ten Commandments have been labeled outmoded and dangerous for dealing with morality in modern society, because many believe there is no absolute right or wrong. Are we really better off without any standards? Something to think about.